Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Thank you for being here, and it's wonderful to be here as well. Well, eternal life is what's on our mind, isn't it? When we contemplate that, it seems to be an unreal, so far away, maybe, isn't it? I just want to go through some thoughts with you in regards as to how one might obtain eternal life. It is certainly, I can guarantee you that, Bible guarantees it, it is better than life itself as you know it. You know, you may be very happy, and I trust and I believe you are, but we haven't really, really lived yet. You understand? That's still to come. So eternal life, what does God say about eternal life? Well, Jesus gives counsel. He says, you have to abide in him, and he will abide in you. A two-way street. So we need that connection. We can't go outside, around, or over, or under it. You have to have a condition where you abide in him, and he abides in you. What will it be like? Sometimes I try to visualize, and I search the internet for images. But I know already that what is there is beyond our understanding and our comprehension. That is how good it will be. Man by the name of Peter Larson, he is actually a paleontologist and a critic, he says this. He said, you know, when it comes to the belief about Jesus, and by the way, if Jesus wasn't true, suppose, then we have yet to learn about God, haven't we? Say he wasn't an imposter. You would yet have to learn about God, if there is a God, because then you have to start doubting that as well. It's interesting, he makes his observation. He said, you know, he said, there's no such thing as staying neutral. The life of Jesus is bracketed between two impossibilities as far as our humanity is concerned. Two impossibilities. One is the virgin womb, the virgin birth, and the other one is an empty tomb. How many people do you know personally that have gotten out of the grave? Alive, I mean. Wow. And virgin birth, don't try to tell the family because they're not going to believe it. And by the way, neither did they with Jesus in his hometown. And so we have two miraculous impossibilities that were made possible. It would have to be, if Jesus was a product of Joseph and Mary, he'll be a new individual. He couldn't be an incarnation. And if Jesus would not have come out of the tomb, the whole plan of salvation would have failed, because the essence is that he did come back to life. And so the reality is this. We are asked to believe the doctrine of the resurrection. I'll tell you what. We are asked to meet the resurrected person. And his name is Jesus Christ. Because if you meet him, then he was resurrected. And if he was resurrected by way of a miracle, certainly he was brought about, born a human being by way of a miracle. And this is what we've got to understand. We as Christians, we certainly have big asks when we want people to believe what may appear to be impossible. Mind you, for by way of consolation, it is not as bad when you consider the impossibilities if you take God out of the equation. Do you understand what I'm saying? When you take God out of the equation, you have to believe in much bigger miracles than the virgin birth and the resurrection from the dead, let me tell you. Now, doubts. Doubts is a terrible thing. My advice, if you have doubt, and it can happen, to the best of us. If you have doubt, my advice to you is doubt your doubts. Are they really reasonable? You see, failures don't define you. We all hate failures, don't we? We hate to fail in the relationship, we hate to fail in the job, we hate to fail in whatever we set out to do. It is not nice to fail, but failure does not define you. You can always start again. But when you doubt, doubt does define you because you never progress. You understand? You're only a failure if you never get up again. And doubt can stop you from doing that. I will not believe. You know, I come across people who have made that decision. They will not believe. They put, but no matter the evidence, they put, by the way, don't try this at home, they put their head in the sand, if you understand. They do. And therefore, I do not believe. Often, believing, non-believing, is a choice. Correct? That's what it is. That's what it is. Ernest Hemingway, that journalist and writer, American, he wrote this, last century. He said, the best way to find out if you can trust somebody is this way. He says, trust me. Don't you like that?
Yeah.
Now, it doesn't always work. I'm you understand. But if you don't trust anybody, it is never going to work. You are never going to trust anybody. And so the ask here is that we trust the Bible and the God of the Bible and the Christ of the Bible and put our faith in him. That is what we challenge to do. Albert Einstein, that great German scientist, or everybody knows, he was a Jew. I'm not sure whether he ever really accepted Jesus Christ as his personal savior. But this is what he said. He said, you know, I'm a Jew, but I am enthralled by the luminous figure of the Nazarene. That means Jesus of Nazareth. You come from Nazareth, you're called the Nazarene. He said, no one can read the Gospels without feeling the actual presence of Jesus. He puts it even stronger. He said his personality pulsates in every word. Is that your experience when you read the Gospels? Because that is true. He says, no myth, meaning no other story, no other religious book, no other whatever you could find on the face of this planet is filled with such a life when you read the New Testament. And for that matter, I would include the Old Testament. You really, truly see and feel his presence. And that's wonderful. That's wonderful. Billy Graham, still alive, 97, 98, Parkinson's, he's obviously not well. What a career. He said this when it comes to struggling with full acceptance. The mind can proceed only so far upon what it knows and what it can prove. Did you follow that? He says there comes a point where the mind takes a leap. You understand? I like to think that you're connected with this because we sometimes are. You know, a Christian walks by faith, correct?
Yeah.
Not always by sight. He also said this. He said, no matter how much knowledge you gather, wouldn't matter. No matter how much proof you accumulate, and there's a lot, no matter how much, you will never know the Lord Jesus Christ without any taking the certain leap of faith. There is a point in your life where, despite everything that you know, you have to really make that complete surrender. And that's an act of faith. It truly is. That salvation only comes from him, as it does. It only comes from Jesus Christ. Martin Luther, that 16th century reformer, he says this, he said, you know, it's one thing to say that Christ is a savior, He said, it's interesting, it's quite another thing to say that Christ is, Jesus is my Savior. And then he goes on to say, and he's so right, the devil can say the first. He can. Because he knows Christ is a Savior. He fights him every day. And he sets the perimeters every day. The devil can say the first, but the true Christian alone can say the second. Angels can't say it, nobody can say it, but it's only Christians, only the redeemed. Only the redeemed can say that. He is my Savior. So what are the obstacles? What are the obstacles that, despite our church attendance, despite our upbringing, despite our introduction to certain belief systems, despite our knowledge, still can stop us? It's interesting. What was it about the rich young ruler? Well, what did he have to learn? You cannot serve God and mammon. What was his problem? You see, he acknowledged Jesus, he believed Jesus, but he didn't go through. What stopped him? His possessions. That is what stopped him. He couldn't part with it. I look at a man like David. David, in his incident, I suppose when you think of David, you always think of Bathsheba. It's a bit like Bill Clinton and what's her name again? Yeah, it'll never die, and in the coming election, he'll get to hear about it a great deal. But that's okay, people will bring it back. But the man after God's heart, good people do terrible things sometimes. And there's an example. Now, if I asked you, you know, this is an obstacle, and it's a huge obstacle. I think we mustn't underestimate the obstacle in order to get to eternal life. Now, if I asked you, what commandment did David break, what would you say?
Adultery.
I knew you'd come up this day. Let's go through the list. Let's just go through the list and see how serious any sin basically is. Let's go from the bottom up. The 10th commandment deals with what?
Coveting.
Okay. He coveted his neighbor's wife. Did he break that commandment? Oh, absolutely. Number 9. What is number 9? Silence.
Shall not bear false witness.
Ah, he was lying about his sin. He was trying to hide it. Hiding the truth is lying. Number 8. What's number 8? Oh, come on.
Thou shalt not steal.
Yes, well, he did. He stole his neighbor's wife. Is that correct? Number 7 we know, that's clear, he no adultery, he did do that. Now go to number 6, go to number 6. What is number 6?
He shall not kill.
Yeah, he killed her husband, he murdered her husband. What about 5? He was brought up differently, he dishonored his parents. Surely. Let's say he kept number 4. Let's say nothing happened on the Sabbath. Let's give him that. That's fair enough. You happy with that? Okay. So we go to number 3. We go to number 3. Shaming God. Now he, as the king, was meant to be the example. God had anointed him. God had put him there. God had blessed him. What did he do? I would say he took the name of God in vain. There's many ways you can do that. 2nd commandment: you shall not make any graven image. Well, he liked the image that he was looking at, and she became his idol. Number 1, you shall have no other God before you. First commandment was broken because his passion was his God, and that put the real God on the second place. Fair enough? It's interesting when you look at sin. Often I think back. I want to understand the grace of God, the patience of God, the forbearance of God, I'm still here, that he's accepted me and pulled me in. And I'm grateful for that. That's a wonderful thing when you can look back how wrong you were and how easy it was to be wrong. That was a piece of cake. And so, the enemy of souls, we are no match for Satan. There's no question about it. Jesus said about him, he was a murderer from the beginning, and he's a liar, and he is the father of it. He walks about, the Apostle Peter says, like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. You know, there's one thing about Satan, he'll try everything to drag you down again. The last thing he wants is for you to make it to life eternal. You understand? Because he knows he's not going to make it. He knows. And so, we have a formidable enemy who uses sin. Sin always takes you further than you want to go. Does that make sense to you? Keeps you longer than you wanted to stay. It does that. Also, it costs you more than you wanted to pay. Always. Always. Let's have a look at the obstacles when it comes to sin. I think there's a good few considerations here. Often we think of sin, whatever it is, if we do it, it's not so bad. Someone else does it, it's worse. Often we think of things that God doesn't really mind. Well, if Satan tempts you into it, then God does mind. Satan has a better idea what the criteria are for God than sometimes we people. Frederick William Robertson was a 19th century English preacher. And he put it like this, the consequences of sin. If you think that you can sin and then by Christ avert the consequences of sin, he says you insult God's character. Have you ever read anywhere not to mock God? Yeah? You know it, you do it, you shouldn't have. Then you expect God, you know, do it now and ask for forgiveness later. I'm not saying the forgiveness is not forthcoming, but what you must realize is that the consequences can really bite. And there's a reality here. Reinhold Niebuhr, another Christian commentator, author, all human sin seems much worse in its consequences, notice, than in its intention. You didn't mean to go that far. You didn't mean to hurt anybody else, but you did. And you can't turn the clock back. Now you're going to live with it or hand it over to Christ. Edwin Lewis Cole, he wrote a lot of books on man and religion. The function of man as the father, the head of the household, as the husband. He's very good. He wrote quite a few papers on this. The torment of temptation, he said, is nothing. He mainly ministered to the man. He said, don't worry about the torment of temptation. It's nothing. He said, compared to the consequence of sin, it is so much worse. You see, though sin can be forgiven immediately, the consequences of sin can last a lifetime. True? Now, I'm just bringing some of the realities, because those consequences can keep you out of eternal life, because they can really overwhelm you or others. Jesus forgave his friends in the rivers. I think this was actually quite a brilliant statement. Have a look at it. She says, Jesus forgave the thief. You know the thief on his right-hand side?
Yeah.
She said, but it's remarkable, he did not take him down from the cross. You understand? Well, he could have. He had the power, but he didn't employ that. So he was there for the consequences of his sin. Jesus paid for the sins of the whole world. Why try to pay for your own? You know, if you lose the connection with Christ, you end up paying for your own sin. What a silly thing to do if you consider that Jesus already paid the penalty for your sins.
Mm.
Yeah? It doesn't make sense. Mahatma Gandhi, he of course was not a Christian. He, you know who he is. He was the one that the main drive with a non-violent protest for the independence of India from, of course, from the bombs. You know the story, everybody knows about him. He lived for years in practice in South Africa, where he was very active as well. He said this, it's interesting, that he's actually a Hindu. He said, I do not seek redemption from the consequences of my sin. I seek to be redeemed from sin itself. I thought that was a very good statement. Most of the times we are looking to get rid of the consequences of sin. But what we are forgetting, we need to get rid of the sin itself. That is our problem. And he says, until I have attained to that end, I shall be content to be restless. In other words, I won't be satisfied. Pity he didn't know Jesus, because Jesus could have helped him. He could have. William Barclay, who had such a tremendous career, again, a Christian commentator, radio, and later on this television as well. Real repentance means that a man has come not only to be sorry for the consequences of his sin, he has now progressed to actually hating sin itself. That's where we got to get at. How do you get there? How do you get there? I know we all hate the feeling of guilt, but I'm talking about real actually hating the sin for what it is and what it does to you and us. Escape from sin is obviously the way to eternal life. There's no question about it. We must escape this. The wages of sin is death. We know that. True? I don't need anybody to convince. You know that. The gift of God, can you finish that for me, is what? That is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. True? See, it's a reality that actually nobody ever did and nobody ever will actually escape the consequences of their choices. And so this is the reality that we deal with. Apostle Paul, I love this statement. I have always found this one of the most beautiful statements in the whole of the Bible. When he writes to the Corinthians, he said, no temptation has overtaken you except such as common to men. He said, what's been happening to you has happened elsewhere. It's not uncommon. But God is faithful, he said, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make a way of escape. Have you ever understood this text? Have you ever applied it? Good. I'm glad. It took me years to use this. It took me years. I looked at it and I didn't understand it. This temptation will also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Bear what? The temptation. Here you have an absolute removal, you have an absolute removal of any excuse to sin. You understand? Yeah? This one is removed because he says there is a way of escape. God is giving you a way of escape. If God is giving you the ability to turn away from sin, you gotta take that. And here it is. If we confess, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. Now finish it for me. Absolutely. And to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You want to try this. It begins by confession. And then you let him work in you and through you. And the cleansing will follow. There is a cleansing. A new moral taste, and you're on your way to eternal life.
Amen.
Grace is getting what we don't deserve, but what we need. Mercy is not getting what we do deserve, we don't deserve it, but our Father in heaven offers both. How do you like that?
Yeah.
He offers both. Be very, very, very blessed. You cannot earn God's favor because it simply is a gift. Both grace and mercy are on offer. Joyce Meyer, I don't know whether you know who she is. She's a television evangelist. I did some concerts sometimes.
Horrible.
She says a few good things. This is one of them. I am not where I need to be, but thank God, she says, I am not where I
used to be.
I think that's progress, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think it's a terrific statement. I like it. I like it. She's not that horrible. We reveal our value of Jesus Christ by the degree to which we allow the life of Christ to be reproduced in our lives. Would you agree with this? Yeah? This is a prerequisite to eternal life. You have to allow the life of Christ to flow through into your life. Remember, abide in me, and then he will abide in you. And that has to become a fact. That has to be a daily reality. It must be. You know the millennials? It's interesting. Kids think differently. Millennials, how would you describe it? There are different criteria and parameters. But I would say anybody that was born in the early 1980s, which obviously is not me. I was born in the earlier. And so between the 1990s. So these are now the early 20s to mid-30s. And they make up about 33% of the workforce in this country or most developed countries. So they have a very different outlook on life. The CNN did a survey on this, and they're looking at the phenomenon that this group is not going to church. They are really avoiding church. They are leaving church. And they tried to find out why, and they said because it was because the churches were not meeting their. What was the time there? Is it? Time is fine, isn't it? Yeah. Okay. So leaving the church because the church did not meet their what?
Wants.
Now that's interesting. Now that is interesting. I talk to other pastors and you ask them, how you going? And they tell you about the congregations. And then they say they have, this mob is missing. And I always like to say, we've got most of them. Which is not, well, actually, we got quite a few of them. But it's a very different generation. They prefer Jesus to follow them, not the other way around. Yeah, they believe in going in the same direction as Jesus, but it's better if he follows them rather than them following Jesus. That's the way it is. They think differently. There's a different mindset. There are different criteria. There are different priorities. So different. And they are very hard mob to read. Ever heard of that? It's becoming a new science. Don't laugh, it's serious. That this is becoming a new science. Wantology. Yeah, it is, it's serious. It's all about reading. Good. It's all about me. What I want, then I want. Does that make sense? That's what that generation is about. A wantologist, this is serious, it's a branch now of psychology. They help clients verbalize their latent, unrequited desires, the ones that you haven't given up, the ones that are still there, the ones that are eating in you. You want to do it. It's you, it's your makeup. You need it, they say. And so here we have the people, here we have professional people mobilizing, recognizing what is inside you in that regard. And they move them towards achieving, notice, happiness by identifying the ways they can satisfy those desires. They make them believe if you can satisfy those desires, you are going to be happy. Yeah? Well, that's what they say. That's what they say. Okay, I don't agree with it either. The goal of ontology is to help clients connect the dots of desires, what they do want, and how they can get it. Imagine going down that road. That's, by the way, if eternal life is that way, with that you're going that way. It's the opposite. You understand? Totally 100% the wrong direction. So you keep calm, because it's not you. No, it's me. It's about me. You don't matter. I'm important. God can always provide for us more effectively than we ever can provide for ourselves. He knows the amount of hairs on our head. Can you believe it? Which is more in some cases than other cases, nevertheless. That is what he believes. That's what he says. That's what the Bible teaches. Really, we need to study a needology. How do you pronounce it? Yeah, that'll do it.
Needology.
That is what we need to look at. That's what we need to study. That's what we need to be aware of. Eternal life. Eternal life is not simply the length of time after death. It's not. It's far more than that. The quality of life which is now and could be and should be ours right now. The certainty that you have it. The certainty that this is already achieved with you and for you is a liberating experience that will raise you above the commonalities of life. In a sense, you see everything different. There's a purpose, there's a journey, and you're on it, and your arrival is certain. That is what that is about. And will eternally be ours throughout the ages. That is what we are looking for. To abide in him is to abide in his word and to meet him daily in prayer. Now, prayer. When you read prayer, I think of a man that is normally known out there for the fact that he survived the night in the lion's den. Another thing you wouldn't try at home. And so, Daniel prayed 3 times a day. Yeah, true? Mm-hmm. He said. Now, not because he was good. I want you to see the difference here. Daniel didn't pray because he was good 3 times a day. He was good, but he was so good because he prayed 3 times a day. Can you see the difference here? Try it. This is what you should try about. Start praying 3 times a day. Yeah. Yeah. Listen, if the Muslims can do it 5 times, we should be able, you know, really. We should be doing that. We should be picking this example. The Jews traditionally used to do this. 3 times a day. Everything he brought to God during the day. The more you talk to someone, the more you have to talk about. And that was Daniel. That was Daniel. To abide in his word. Jesus said clearly this. To abide in his word. And Jesus said to those Jews who believed him. Who was he talking about? Who was he talking to? No, not the disciples, there were other Jews. What does he say about them? What did they do? It's there, black and white. Well, white and black. To those who what? Yes, they believed on him. He didn't have to convince them anymore. They believed on him. Did you get that? Like you and me. And then he said this. He said, if you abide in my word. Now the operative word is if, and the second one is abide. What do you understand abiding to mean?
Remain.
A permanency, correct? An ongoing. He said, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples. In other words, Even if you believe, but you do not abide in my words, you are not my disciples. He says, and you shall know the truth. Now, the word know in Hebrew means an experiential reality. So you shall experience the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Love this text, because it's true. But you have to remain abiding in his word. Their faith, they believed in him, but their faith was not made perfect through obedience. They believed it, but they didn't walk the talk. They didn't live it. Get it? That's the problem. Taking up your cross and follow him is a necessity. Note what Jesus did not say. Jesus did not say you shall feel the truth. It is not subject to feeling. He said you shall what?
No.
This is important. We still go by feelings. It feels okay, so we do it. That is too dangerous. Far too dangerous. Alright. We have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. Note what John says here. He says, he didn't say that love is God. That's not the same thing. You understand? A cow is an animal, but not every animal is a cow. You understand? So he says, God is love. That is what he is. That's the one terrific description you find in the Bible. And he who abides in love, abides in God. That word abiding is central to your journey. And God in him. This is so essential. The world is seeking, looking for love in all the wrong places, all the wrong ways. True love is only found by those and in those who abide in God. If you want to experience true love, no, I'm not talking about likes, dislikes. I'm talking about true love. You need to abide in Christ. If you're not interested, you'll never experience it. You won't. You won't. If God sees that we are ready to love others, he will bring them to us. Not before. He will bring them to us when we're ready to love, or he'll bring us to them. You are to love one and another. Remember? To love one and another. That's a condition here. 1 John 4:18. There is no fear in love. But perfect love casts out fear. You know this text, because fear involves torment, and he who fears has not been made perfect in love. There's something wrong still between you and your maker. And you got to solve it. You got to go to him in prayer. We love him because we respond to the love that was first there. He loved us first. We know that. Francis Chanis is the preacher, Baptist preacher, and he said this: do you know that nothing you do in this life, he said, will ever matter unless it's about loving God and loving the people he has made? And he's right. That is a good preaching. God's love never fails. Whatever you're going through, it is well and truly within the perimeter and the sphere of his love. Never believe if you go through a tough time, you're out of favor with God. No, no. He's trying to pull you in. You can remember that. That's true. And so, I admit, I'm weak, but I have a strong God. Any of us can win this battle. Whatever the battle is, you can, for sure. We're almost there. Are we fishing for Jesus? We can spend a lot of time learning about Jesus, but you know what I think we should really be doing is fishing with Jesus to get to the others. Because he'll give you the power, he'll give you the tact, he'll give you everything that you need. You will benefit when you take it to others. If you keep it within your own doors, you will not grow. So, the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life. That's Solomon in his good days. And he who wins souls is
wise.
There's wisdom. Winning souls. I conclude with the story of this man, but it's rather he in a way found eternal life, I think. I'm sure he did. I don't know too much about his religious experience, but I read about this. Master Sergeant Ronnie Edmonds, of the 422nd Infantry Regiment US Army, he died in 1985. He was active in the Second World War. Now, this was an Allied invasion that went pear-shaped, and it was known there as the Battle of the Bulge. And what meant that is that the Germans, the Nazis, took a lot of the Allied forces prisoner. And he was one of them. And there were about 120 of them that were in this particular concentration camp. They were there for quite some time, and then there in January 1945, there was an order that they wanted all the Jews, amongst the soldiers, to be handed over to the Germans, and you know why. They would send them to either an extermination camp, or they would simply just put them into such a condition that within a couple of months they would simply die by the brutality that they were to receive. And so, Sergeant Roddy Edmonds was told. You know how they found this out? They never knew about him until after his death. His son, Chris Edmonds, is a preacher, and it was his daughter who did a project for school on the family. Actually she was given by the widow, she was given a book that was all faded, a little book that was actually a diary, and he recorded the incident I'm about to share with you. It impressed me, it really did. And because Chris Edmonds was close to his dad, but he never really got his old man to talk about the years that he was in prison. He never said much about that. It was almost off limit. Anyway, they found out the truth because it was recorded. And this is fascinating. He was ordered by the major that ran that concentration camp, and his name was Siegmann. Major Herr Major Siegmann. That's who it was. And they were to line up, he was to hand over early in the morning those Jews. Next morning, all 120 men were standing there. And a commandant came and he said, "You can't all be Jews." And Roddy Edmonds says, "Yes, we are." And that major knew that the man was rebelling against his direction. So he got the gun, the pistol that he held in his holster, and he put it right at the forehead of Reynolds. And he said, "Unless you bring them out, I'm going to shoot you." And that man apparently never blinked an eyelid. According to the Geneva Convention, we are to tell you our rank, name, and serial number. You shoot me, you have to shoot everybody else. And after the war, they will hold you in a court as a war criminal, and you'll have to answer for your deeds. Now, that could have gone either way. But that major, this was 1945 January, the Germans weren't doing too well. They were losing on a number of fronts. And so he just stormed off in a rage. And the Jews in his regiment were saved. There's an organization that the Jews have. It's called the Yad. Yeah, it's called the Yad Vashem. Vashem. That's really the proper pronunciation. The Yad Vashem. That is an organization, an institute, where anybody who was exterminated in the camps and had no posterity, their names would be recorded because they would be pronounced righteous. because though there's no posterity, they go to eternal life. The daughter submitted this to this organization. And do you know that this man, this Sergeant Ronnie Edmonds, as far as the Jews are concerned, I don't know about God, but I hope that God looks at it the same way. He became one of the righteous. Non-Jews, but they say he is righteous. He is going to be saved.
An honorary Jew.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, you could say that. You could say that. But the interesting thing is that he is the only American soldier that ever got this distinction. How many of you have ever watched Schindler's List? Everybody watched the movie? He read the same. The same organization recognized him as righteous. And so there you are. What? And this is, of course, a Jewish organization, but this is the point. The decision that you and I make here and now is what determines our destiny. Eternal life cannot be earned. But you need to make the choice. I know some of you linger sometimes. You put it off. Have a look at it at a later date. How do you know you're going to have a later date? I urge you to make a choice for eternal life, because whether or not you will have eternal life is really, really your choice. Wouldn't it be nice if someone came to me and said, it happens sometimes, and it's such a reward that someone says, all right, I want to be baptized. I'm going to walk with Jesus, and I'm going to make it real in my life. I hope, I pray, that you will make this a reality. Don't worry about me, but Jesus is waiting for you to make that commitment, because he made it possible, and therefore you should. May God bless you as you contemplate. And we will have a special item.
Thank you. Precious name.